Well, back by popular demand, Laura House. Hello, Laura House.
Hi, David.
For people who have never heard Laura House, she's an actress, a comedy writer, and comedian. She's written on some of your favorite sitcoms. She was one of the stars of an MTV series. She's a great stand-up comedian. She's in one of my favorite political movies of all time, Janine from Des Moines. How are you?
That's so awesome. I'm good. I'm good, David. That was such a nice intro.
So you're in love? You're in love?
I'm excited about myself.
Are you in love?
I am in love. Yeah. I had a big relationship end last summer, and I did a lot of work working through that. And then I met someone on a dating app 2 weeks ago. But it's like, it's this amazing match.
You met somebody on a dating app.
Isn't that crazy? I never thought it would happen to me. Like, you hope it'll happen, and then it happens, and you're like, what?
Yes. Dating apps. Women go on dating apps.
Well, I don't think it's just women.
I have not finished yet. As I understand dating apps, women go on dating apps and view the men the same way men view porn. They like to flirt with the men, but then when it comes to closing the deal and getting the date, they run away. That has been what I've heard.
Mm-hmm.
That you like being flirted with, but you really don't want to get off the couch and actually go out with a guy.
Is that the end of your point?
That's what I've heard.
There's probably some people like that, but I, in my experience, boys and girls go on there and they talk a little and they date. That's been, I haven't had, so your friends have been, blown off.
Well, I have younger friends who are describing Caligula's wet dream, but they're young. But tell me, have you ever been on a dating app before?
Yeah. What? Yes. Yeah. I did. I was married years ago. And then after that, I got on a dating app. And then after this big, big breakup, I got on a dating app. Yeah.
You met. Yeah, and does it work?
Yeah, it's but I think my friend Scott gave me the best advice, and I didn't follow it years ago because you've been to Jerry's Deli?
You're the third person who's brought up Jerry's Deli in
no
the past
way.
2 weeks. Yes.
No way. Okay. Yeah. So
I heard Jerry's Deli closed.
Did it?
That's what I heard.
I can't. Where are all the people going to go?
The one in the valley, I guess, is still open, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I think.
They still have a bowling alley? Do they still have
it's by the bowling alley.
No, they have a bowling alley.
Yes, they have a bowling alley. Pins with a Z.
Yeah.
I think I would feel it if the one in the valley closed. But it's, so the menu at Jerry's Deli is like overwhelming. So I always feel like you have to be strong, like you have to know what you want to eat. Mm-hmm. And then go into the menu and find it. That's
right.
What I think at Jerry's Deli. So it's the same with dating apps. I think my friend Scott was like, just know 99.9% of the people on there are awful. This is the internet. And I was like, oh, like that's. And so at first I didn't think so because I would feel bad, like, you know, because based, like, if you're sitting at a bar and, I'll put these in your terms. So you're sitting at a bar and Cindy Crawford approaches you and strikes up a conversation. Do you feel good or bad about yourself?
If who walks up to me?
Cindy Crawford.
She's a married woman. I would say, get away from me.
A single woman who
Mr.
looks a
Gerber.
Lot like Cindy Crawford.
I'm sorry?
Walks up to a single woman who looks a lot like Cindy Crawford, beautiful, walks up to you, starts talking. How do you feel about yourself?
I would say you should get that mole on your face looked at.
Cindy. Okay, this example is not going to work.
All right, come up with somebody else.
Natalie Portman walks up to you, but a single woman who looks a lot like Natalie Portman walks up to you.
I would say you are a very attractive Jewish woman. You and Scarlett Johansson are my two favorite Jewish women. I would like to take you and Scarlett Johansson back to my apartment for menage a trois, but since you're Jewish, we'll make it a menage a deux.
Oh, nice.
Thank you.
So even though you blow it with her, you probably feel pretty good about yourself that this beautiful woman
if
was
Natalie Portman walked up to me, can I answer that question?
Sure.
Okay. Somebody sent me a picture of me on The Tonight Show, and Jay Leno is sitting to my left, and Jennifer Gardner is clutching my arm. I will post this to my website.
Okay.
And what was that sound?
We're under siege. There's an airplane. Now it's passed.
And Jennifer Gardner, who I don't know if you know this, but she's very attractive, is clutching my arm. And I'm not making this up. She is saying, "You're such a nasty, nasty man," like flirtatiously.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sending out signals of, are you blind? Are you messing with me?
Mm-hmm.
What do you think you're looking at? Now, granted, I was married and I wasn't going to act on it. But and I knew that even if I try to act on it, she would either come to her senses or say, I always talk to men this way. Why did you misread these signals? So if Jennifer Gardner or Cindy Crawford walked up to me and started flirting, I immediately would say, obviously I'm misreading her signals.
Okay. So if a woman who looked like, I don't want to be mean, let's say looked something like a character Ruth Buzzy would play, walks up to you.
Mm-hmm.
How do you feel about yourself? Good or bad?
Well,
or with your low self-esteem, are you like, yeah, this makes sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. Well, let's go back to your place and hit me with your purse the way you used to hit Artie Johnson.
Well, my point is on that I didn't make is on dating apps is if you don't have in mind that 99% of the people are gross, then if 10 creepy, gross people would message me or whatever, and then like 10 years ago, I would think like, oh, I guess this is what I attract. Like, oh, I guess I'm not very appealing. Or I guess this is my level. And you can't go into it. You have to like know who you are and what you want and just be like, no, 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 no. Okay. Like, to look to find that unicorn that you like.
Do you find that you go on a dating app and you see a picture of a guy and that picture informs how you understand all the other pertinent details about the guy?
Like I'm filtering whatever I'm reading through that picture?
Mm-hmm.
Maybe. I guess I do think the picture thing affects guys different than it does girls.
That I've been told is no longer true, that women can be stimulated by porn, that they can be stimulated visually.
Oh yeah, no,
we've always been told that's not the case.
No, I think it's less a matter of you can be stimulated and more a matter of whether that's the priority. And I still think for women, that's not necessarily the priority. And I think it kind of is still the priority for guys, if that makes sense.
Women, let me tell you something about women. Women are like cholesterol.
Okay, yeah.
You
want them to go down on you.
They right, and they're murder on your heart. And nobody will tell us the truth about cholesterol. They say there's good cholesterol, there's bad cholesterol, but the bad cholesterol may be good, and the bad cholesterol might be bad, or the good might be good, and the bad might... We really don't know, and we're going to do all these studies. And now, okay, we've absolutely determined that a lot of cholesterol is bad for you, but you should eat food that's high in cholesterol because it actually lowers your cholesterol. That's what women are, because we hear the same things about women. That
just
they
twisty, crazy nonsense.
They don't care if a man is bald. They don't care what a man looks like.
Because, here's the reason, and I'll filter this down to one thing. Because it is case by case. Like I don't like bald guys, but this dude is kind of bald, and I really like this guy. So it's
what do you
fine.
Mean you don't? What do you mean you don't like bald guys?
I don't like bald guys. Who likes bald guys? Nobody.
That's why I got hair plugs, right? What about hair plugs?
But I don't. But like some people are like, oh, I love bald guys because they were like, you know, had a an uncle who was bald. I don't know what, but I didn't grow up around. I don't inherently like bald guys.
What about a
like,
bald guy who shaves his head?
But that's what I mean is like, no, like across the board, I'm going to say no. But this guy is pretty much bald, but I like him, so it's fine. Does that make sense?
How important are looks?
So that's not me being twisty, weird, whatever. That's me going... It's other things are a priority for me. Looks are only important in they're not as they're important in the sense of like I don't know you at all, and there's a certain level of attractiveness I need to think I could be attracted to you. But it's not that high, and it's more of like who you are in an interesting way. Like ultimate guy, John Goodman. Is he Brad Pitt? No, he's John Goodman.
What do you mean ultimate guy? What do you mean ultimate?
Best guy. If I could have any guy, when you think of like your fame crush, John Goodman.
You're wrong.
No.
You're wrong.
I'm not wrong.
He doesn't fit the... He's overweight. He doesn't fit. He can't be...
No, he's the guy. He's the guy. He's the guy. So...
Because he's so talented.
Bill Murray doesn't fit the, like, ooh, hot guy. But any woman would want to be with Bill Murray. But...
I get Bill Murray. So it's like that.
It's like... You know, generally, if you go, hey, do you want a big, giant, fat guy? And you're like, I don't know. Maybe, generally, I don't know. I mean, for me, the answer is generally yes. But it's like...
But if you saw John Goodman...
Some mean guy. Like, I like kind of a big, fat, funny guy. But, like, my last boyfriend, who I liked a lot and was with for years, was very, like, lean and athletic. So I just put up with it.
When are you going to stop taking care of yourself?
But it was annoying because he was just kind of vain. Like, I just want like a normal, you know, like a nice guy with like a dad bod is like fine, because it's like there's a cost to the person who like looks really good. I find there's a like they're always late everywhere because they change clothes 10 times.
Guys.
Yes. Because I don't date women generally.
But guys are changing clothes 10 times? I don't change my clothes 10 times a month.
I know, not you. You would be a perfect guy for me. I just want a guy who doesn't care what he looks like. Someone like you, David.
Speaking of smell, shouldn't dating apps have smell-o-vision? Shouldn't you be able to smell a potential date before you go out with him?
I guess that would be ideal, wouldn't it?
It's all about smell. I was interviewing an animal behaviorist last week, and she says before she decides whether or not to go out on a second date, she will sniff the guy's neck.
Okay. I mean, is that straight up smell or is that like a pheromone chemistry?
I guess thing? The pheromones. Yeah, she's very concerned.
Well, that's why, like I, here was my experience with dating apps was like some people like this last guy we messaged quite a bit. And here's another reason I think women, there's maybe a reputation of, they want to talk to you and flirt and stuff, and then they don't want to go out on a date, is I had many situations of, like, you're talking to someone, talking, then they say something weird and gross, and then you just stop talking to them. Mm-hmm. So they ended up being off-putting in some way that maybe men aren't working into that story.
We were talking,
and then she didn't go out with me. Sure. I told her I liked ass play, but, like, I don't know why she had to be such a bitch about it. Like, that's like, I guess she just wanted to sit on the sofa and not date. It's like, no, like, maybe that's why you have the messaging, so you can go, oh, can I, you know, is something about you off? Some guys start in with, like, oh, hey, sweetie, hey, baby, gross. No. You don't assume a relationship that doesn't exist. Or some guys go on too long and that's boring, or they, you know, one guy was like, we were talking real, you know, pretty good. And I was like, oh, I would meet this guy. And then he was like, oh my God, can I, he was like, oh, you're a comedian. Can I go see a show? I just think it'd be so cool to know a comedian. And I was like, it's just guys. If you talk to them too long, they will say something that makes you not want to meet them.
So how accurate a barometer is the text messaging?
I think it's pretty accurate. Like, because you know if someone's bugging you or, like, if some, like, I've had stuff that, like, maybe something in their texting was, like, hitting me weird, but I was like, you know what? I don't really know this person. And then I met them, and then that same thing, I was like, yeah, there's something, like, passive-aggressive about the way they are, and that's what I was sensing in the messages, so I got that.
What about teasing you?
Oh, when guys tease, because that, I'm not into that, but I'm also older. Older women, I think it's not, like, I can't believe I'm an older woman and I'm kind of bragging about it right now, but it's like, that's more of like a younger woman, a way to trick younger women.
So it's not appealing to annoy women teasingly?
Not me, but there was a time when, yes, that I only dated guys like that because it felt like banter and it felt like I wanted guys to like me so much that it kind of actually like turned up the volume on me wanting this guy to like me, which is exactly what the playbook says for like how to pick up women. So it sadly like worked on me all the time. Because, if a guy was teasing about, I don't know, what, then, you know, my reaction internally is like a giggle and like, then I better not do that anymore or whatever. It's sad. But like a lot of younger women, you want validation from men so much that like, and then it's also like, oh, he's kind of cool and aloof and now I want him anymore. You know, now I want him more or whatever. But as an older woman, I'm just looking for like a dude to like, you know, watch TV with till we die. So like, I just want a nice man, like hard to get or what, like I need a dude who like knows himself and is like loving, open, I'm interested in you, can come out and say it, can communicate. Like I've had so many bad experiences with, cause I've mostly just been attracted to like funny, charming people and they're the worst. They're the worst people to partner with.
So I like to lay on the couch with my Kindle for 12 hours at a stretch.
Oh, my God.
Look up at a woman and say...
So hot to me.
I like to look up at the woman every 4 hours and say, fetch me a seltzer from the fridge, doll.
Uh-huh.
Is that unattractive?
You know what, David? We're friends, so I don't want to flirt with you, but to me, that's very attractive. That would be like the greatest thing to me. Because I would be like, I would come back with something other than what you asked for.
Mm-hmm.
And be like, why don't you, here's this, and you can also eat a dick. And then we would just and then I would go back to watching Law and Order, and you're on Kindle. Like, I would, it's kind of a great match.
Mm-hmm. But you didn't answer my question. Are you going to fetch the seltzer for me?
I might. Because also, you've been good and, like, not bothering me for 4 hours, which I appreciate.
And then when you wave the seltzer in my face,
mm-hmm.
and you get between my eyes and the Kindle with the seltzer, and I say, just put it on the table.
Mm-hmm.
Dismissively.
Mm-hmm.
Is that going to make you
horny? If we're a couple,
uh-huh.
and if when I bring you the seltzer, it doesn't make you put the Kindle down and want to make out with me,
mm-hmm.
then it's not going to work. But if you're like, oh, you brought me the seltzer, let's make out for a while, then I would be like, okay, nice.
But I'm negging you by saying, put it on the table. Women like that. It's a power thing. I'm playing with your self-esteem.
Oh, yeah, yeah. See, that's not a... Yeah, again, that was great for me as a younger lady. I would be like, oh, I guess I should try harder to get this guy's attention because no one's dad really loved them, right? So I think women were always sort of trying to get dad's attention through, you know, some dude.
I'm going to say something as the father of daughters,
yeah,
and a divorced man.
Yeah.
I think my sister had a really great relationship with my father. I think that was pretty healthy. My father was pretty remarkable.
Mm.
I know very few women who, they always talk about men and their mommy issues. I think some of the biggest problems in this world can be traced to women and their unresolved daddy issues.
Oh, yeah.
Because I don't think, I'm going to get into trouble here. But
so far, I'm on your side.
I guess I wanted to sleep with my mother and kill my father, right?
I don't totally understand that.
As well, you've never seen my mother.
Other than intellectually. Oh, got it, yeah.
But women, Freud, the Electra complex, Freud kind of threw up his hands and said, I don't know. I don't know what they want. Especially with their fathers. Is that fair to say that?
Yeah, I would say if someone made me on a podcast talk about this, I would say I so much of my adult moves are to get my dad's attention. And I didn't know till later. Like, you don't know at the time. You feel like you're an independent, strong woman. But a lot of it, like... It only occurred, like, years ago. Did I ever tell you the story that
hang on for 1 second. Let's pursue this for a second.
Okay.
Are you looking for a man who's like your father?
No, not consciously, but unconsciously, I was looking for someone. I kept dating people who had the same interplay with me as my father, which is...
Stupid.
Which is aloof. Like, I like guys who, like, they like me, so they're around, but also they're kind of not around. They're kind of 1 foot out the door, which was, like, kind of my dad.
But unless you're Mackenzie Phillips's dad, there are certain barriers between the father and the daughter, right?
I guess, but I think, maybe, but like my friend Katie, for example, her dad, it was one of those, like, she was the apple of his eye. Like, her dad was crazy about her and her sister, and not in a gross way, mm-hmm. in a very sweet way, and loved them. And she married someone, the nicest guy, who was just like her dad. But just this great guy. And I, like, always looked at that relationship like, oh my God. Whereas I, like, oh, this guy's kind of funny. Like my dad, this guy's kind of funny. And he kind of likes me, but I like, I have to really work for it. Like, he doesn't, like, tell me to leave, but he's not really all it, like, and it was only later, like, it's only after, like, 20 years of doing that, you know, you kind of realize, like, oh, shit, like, I basically had to realize, like, I'm never gonna be loved by my dad the way I wanted to be loved by my dad, and I just had to go, well, that's fine, then, and, like, acknowledge it.
For me,
I had to just be like, yeah, you're never going to get that love from your dad. Like, it's over. Like, you had your childhood. Like, you're not going to get re-loved by your father. So it was like, oh, all
right. Do you travel around the world?
He did the best he could. I've been to places around the world.
Do you mind if I ask you a personal question? Did you ever have, I want to use this word, an affair?
In another country?
In another country.
No.
You never had a foreign affair.
No, I didn't.
I think Americans have a very transactional relationship with love and sex.
Oh, yeah. No, I think...
You scratch my back, I'll scratch yours.
Yeah, I think we're real weird about it, for sure.
Because...
But I also can't overcome my whole culture. But yes, we're very much like sex is like a much bigger deal. Hello?
Yeah, I'm listening.
Oh, yeah, sex is like a much bigger deal. And we had sex. What does that mean? Are you mine forever? I don't want to make a wrong move here. What's going on? Like, no, it's a very neurotic, kind of needy, weird thing for sure.
And yet, we're told there's this whole hookup culture out there where people are having sex with no consequences.
Yeah, which is probably the way you're supposed to do it.
Are we?
I don't know. I mean, I don't have the answers. I'm more of like, I just had to figure out what made sense for me, like what I'm looking for. And then I was really lucky in that I like sort of tuned into what I was looking for, and then I seem to have found it. We'll see. You know, time will tell.
How long were you married?
I was married 4.5 years, and then my last relationship was longer, like 6.
Hmm. People change.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Also, some people change more than others. Like, I think some people are in more like I'm more prone to change because I'm like a writer. I'm like an artist, I guess one could say. Mm-hmm. Like a creative, professional creative person. So I'm more apt to change than like some people in some professions. And I just assume that, you know, that's the same all over. Some people are sort of more prone to change than others.
Before we talk about How to Hate Yourself, Trump, and Handmaid's Tale, I want to get back to smell.
Yeah.
This animal behavior... Oops, I keep hitting the... Ms. Vertelin, she's a professor. We had her on, I think, last week. She said that since women have been on the birth control pill, it has altered their smell, their ability to smell. And when they go off the birth control pill, they smell differently and they're attracted to different types of men. In other words, when women are on the birth control pill, they are attracted to the wrong men.
That's fascinating.
And once they get off it, then they are attracted to genetically the right men, the men that can provide them with the right chromosomes and DNA to make the right kind of child.
Oh, wow. What a terrible side effect.
I'm not joking around.
No, I believe you. And it seems like a terrible side effect. That totally makes sense.
Okay. Tell me about How to Hate Yourself.
Don't you want to know what this guy does? He's a professional jazz trumpeter.
The guy you're going out with.
Yes.
Is this La La Land?
Yes. I'm an actress. He's a jazz.
I love jazz.
Well, of course you do. You're boring.
He's a jazz. He's a jazz trumpet.
Yeah, he is.
Where does he play?
He plays all over. He plays in lots of, he's in several bands, and he's in the band Oingo Boingo. Maybe you've heard of them.
Are you kidding me?
No. He has a regular gig downtown on a fancy restaurant rooftop once a week. And yeah, he really is like,
I'm in love.
He's traveled all over the world playing jazz trumpet, and trumpet is like incredibly difficult to play. And yeah, he's really neat.
Is he a good kisser?
Yeah. I mean, Jesus. Yeah. His whole
umberture.
Yeah. It all, most of his focus of his entire life has been put right in that area. Yeah. It's very impressive.
Hmm.
Yeah. He's a great, nice guy. Yeah. So,
and because he plays the, hang on. I got one for 1 second.
Yeah.
Hang on. Let me take a sip of coffee.
Okay.
Here we go. He plays the trumpet. So he's always horny.
Oh boy.
You can have that. You can have that one.
Thank you. Let's call him right now.
I would date a jazz trumpeter.
No, it's really cool because it's something I don't know anything about. I never had any interest in it, but it's this sophisticated, you know, it's this man with this sophisticated culture, you know, to, mm-hmm. that he's developed about himself. He's really neat, but also just seems like a good guy. Again,
what are you thumping there? There's some thumping sound going on.
I don't know.
I'm
sorry, I touched the cord. You've got to calm down.
Do you talk that way to Oingo Boingo Man?
No, I don't.
And what does Oingo Boingo mean?
I get him seltzer. Mm-hmm. If he asks and calls me, would you say baby doll? If he calls me doll, I bring him liquids.
You know what? I've never called a woman babe, sugar, honey. I guess that's...
It doesn't suit you.
No, it doesn't. Sarge. Yeah. I call women Sarge. Sarge,
no, that's good. Like lieutenant. You
know, lieutenant. How to hate yourself.
That's anything military, pretty sexy, colonel, if you're feeling it. Hey, captain.
Tell me about
all the sexy nicknames nobody's talking about. They're just laying there, all the military fun nicknames.
I miss a long-term relationship just because, you know, all the inside jokes and...
Yeah.
And all the things you're not supposed to say that you get to say because you both agree this isn't the thing you're supposed to say, so you say it.
Oh, it's so funny. Yeah, I'd like to have that. That's what I want to have.
Well, if you went out with me, I might treat you to an orgasm in which I scream at the top of my lungs, I wish you were your sister.
I don't have a sister, so I mm-hmm. would just, I could probably handle that better than most. Or I might be like, wait, did you say your sister?
How about this? Making love to you, and I go, name? Name? Laura, thank you.
But that's, like, I have good self-esteem, so I wouldn't be like, oh, he didn't know my name. I'd be like, whoa, this dementia is really kicking up today.
I was just joking around. So tell me about...
You're like, Feldman's dementia is really on fire today.
Are you funny when you're having sex?
Yeah. It turns out I am, but in my last relationship, boy, he would just get mad. He would just be like, that's not good. Could you just stop doing that? It's not. And I was like, oh, like, God forbid you're like playful, mm-hmm. you know, or whatever. And so I found that something I really have to have.
I'm very, by the way, I'm a very, joke coming. Here comes the joke. Yeah. I'm very generous during lovemaking. I always say to the woman first, here, would you like to have the belt around your neck first?
Mm-hmm.
Before See, I put the belt around my sweet. Neck?
Mm-hmm. Where was the joke? The belt thing was the belt,
yeah.
No, I get it now.
How was your Memorial Day? Today is Memorial Day.
Good. I don't do a lot for Memorial Day, I'll be honest. So it's fine. I'm having what I think of as a pretty much a regular Monday.
I went to my sister's last night.
Mm-hmm. And to open presents?
Yes. And they had fireworks.
For Memorial Day Eve?
For Memorial era of Memorial Day. They had fireworks. It doesn't thrill me. I thought, this is what it's like in Syria every day. Right?
How your sister's house?
Just the sound of the fireworks. It's
very
militaristic. And I thought, what do we... With Trump, it's just scary.
I think so many things are like...
But you're a big supporter. You love Ivanka. You always talk about how she speaks for you. And
also, what I appreciate is Melania staying out of the way. Do you know what I mean? Like, give him some room to work. good for her. Like, she knows she would just be in the way. And she's like, I'll just live in another state. It's fine.
Does she have her own...
behind him.
Does she have,
that's what a woman is supposed to do.
Does she have her own agency? And I don't mean modeling. I mean, does she have any freedom? Could she leave him, or is she trapped?
It's so hard to say. If we can boil this down to two points of view, which obviously there's more, of the, look, here's the real truth of that family and the Trump administration and that situation. Here's what it's really like. Like, I'll take what it looks like and I'll tell you what's really happening. And then there are like the pundits and stuff who are like, I know this is, there's nothing is, it's exactly what it looks like. Like, it's exactly, some people are like, this is exact, he does not know what he's doing. There is not a plan. It is exactly what it looks like.
I think it is. I think it's exactly what it looks like.
Yeah,
but I'm asking you about Melania.
Yeah, but that's what I mean is, like, I personally am so, I'm perplexed by everything about this man and everything around him. So I don't know. I mean, I've been wrong about everything. Like, I thought if anyone would maybe break, what do they call it? Break, when you break away, break ranks. Mm-hmm. It would be Tiffany. Like, what has she got to lose? Like, he treats her like shit anyway. And like, you would get so much money in book deals or whatever. You wouldn't need your dad's whatever he can give you. So, which is another, you know, I would have to assume daddy issues are really at work in the women around this dude.
She's gone to Georgetown Law School. She's getting right into the thick of it.
I guess, but I mean, it because she's the one that's sort of almost publicly kind of ousted by that, like part of it, but not really part of it, and she doesn't seem that into it. You know, she's not like, you know, toeing the party line like her sister. So it just, to me, like, I was hoping Tiffany would be like, you know what, he's a real piece of shit or whatever, but like, no. And then Melania, like, I don't, because it's like, could she leave and be free? Yes, but could she do that mentally? I don't know. I wanted to be divorced for, here's my only similarity that I can think of. My marriage, when I was married, it did not work. Like, from the beginning, I was like, oh no. Like, he was like, we should go live with my mom. Like, all these insane things were said that I was like, what? Like, that I didn't think a person would say or do or want. So I was completely unprepared for who this person really was. And he just thought life was done now that we were married. Like, that was the end, not like the beginning. And I asked the priest who married us for an annulment. And he was like, oh, you know, it's just hard in the beginning. I complained to my mom, oh, it's tough in the beginning. I wanted out. And I stayed because, like, oh, maybe it is hard in the beginning. Maybe I do just have to put, maybe it is fine. Maybe I will, like, I stayed for so many. Then my mom was diagnosed with cancer, and then I had this other thing to deal with. And then, but, like, after my mom died, 1 year later, 1 year and one day after my mom died, I woke up and I was like, I can just go. And I did, but it had never, honestly, I am smart. I went to college. I read pretty good, mm-hmm. but it had never actually occurred to me, oh, I can just go. Until that moment was the only, you know, like, that was the only way I could actually do it was when it actually, you know, sort of occurred to me. So I feel like Melania is probably in so deep into something or other. I don't know that it, that she's thinking about leaving.
Is there anything attractive about
it? She doesn't seem like it.
Is there anything that she would find attractive to about Donald Trump? I think that you can convince yourself to fall in love with somebody. I'm reading a biography of Prince Charles, and he said he thought Diana was cute enough I could fall in love with her. I could make myself fall in love with her. Is there anything a woman could do to make themselves fall in love with Donald Trump?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think there, I have been in the presence of a powerful, rich, ugly, mean man. I was a little turned on. And there's another woman who worked for the same guy who talked about, like, primally, it was so weird because she didn't like him, but primally she was, like, drawn to him because he's so alpha. And I was like, yeah, I get it. So, like, there is something about the presence of
the bad guy.
Yeah, and a bad guy and a really confident guy. And also,
are women capable of being attracted to a sociopath when they know he's a sociopath, not when they're surprised?
I think so, because I've had relationships where only later I realized I was it only made sense to me when I realized I was being gaslighted.
Mm-hmm.
But otherwise, like, I'm a cape. You've met me. You think I'm smart enough. But, like, I was being gaslighted by this guy. Like, I want to believe it, so I'm believing it. And, you know, even though a lot of this action doesn't really support that he cares about me that much, like, but he says he does. So, okay, like, I think absolutely, you know, also depends on, like, the holes in your soul, you know, mm-hmm. that you're born with or that you had as a kid, you know, like, for example, this rich, powerful dude, the people who seemed to work around him a lot, it just seemed to fit some thing they came with. Like, it didn't seem to be, like, something they figured out. It seemed to be, like, no, this is a thing I can deal. You know, my dad yelled a lot, or, you know, whatever it was, mm-hmm. that their prickliness filled in some gaps for them, or, you know, was familiar or something in some way they could deal. So, yeah, I think you can be. Also, people say when you talk to him one-on-one, he's very charming. So
are you talking about Trump?
Trump, yeah. So yeah. That's like a problem. Like, that's kind of why another word for charming is manipulative. And mm-hmm. like, I used to just want to be with a charming guy and just have fun, great banter all the time. And now I'm like, ugh, they're just lying. They're terrible people, charming people.
Well, isn't it something like 1 out of 4 humans are sociopaths?
Is that true?
I think it's something like that. I would figure 1 out of 4 people are sociopaths and 1 out of 4 people are charming. I would assume they're the same people.
Probably.
Right? Because they're figuring.
So if 1 out of 4 regular people are sociopaths, you got to figure that much higher for politicians, right? Politicians, actors, anybody who, like, makes their living to the degree that people like them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a crazy person that you don't want to be with.
I think women change. I think they have seasons to their life. I think they have seasons to their month.
Yes.
I don't think men change. I think they get tired.
That's very interesting. I agree with you so far.
I am the same person I was. I'm the same person I was when I was 16. I'm just tired.
Really?
I think so.
Less energy, less willing to put up with stuff, less willing to bend or that sort of thing.
I have the same drive, the same anxiety, the same neuroses, the same nagging doubts, but they're all tired.
Okay.
So that voice that used to go, "You're nothing, you're nothing, you're nothing," now goes, "You're nothing.
It's tired too.
You're nothing."
You're nothing, but you know, go ahead and take a nap. You're going to be nothing when you wake up.
The voice.
See, that's my How to Hate Yourself show is about that voice. I never thought of it. It gets tired as you get tired.
Tell me about the How to Hate Yourself show. What was that? The Improv sold out. You're doing them once a month.
It looks like it. Yeah. 2 years ago, I did How to Hate Yourself as a solo show, and it was just like my stories. I kind of do like two things of like me as me telling stories, and then I sort of bookended it with like me as like almost like a send up of a motivational speaker or whatever of you know, like, but I'm teaching you how to hate yourself with like great tips, you know, like notice people who are better than you, like, just, you know, like stuff where stuff people can really use.
What is the format of the show? If I were to go to the Improv and see it.
It looks like a stand-up show. So the format of the show is I come out, I sort of instill people with the philosophy. I don't really do like a big character, but it's the idea of like, you know, that little voice inside of doubt and shame, and you've done all this stuff to get rid of it, but it comes back. Why does it come back? Because that voice is right. So let's just embrace it. And like, and then I give some talks about like, you know, I found some great ways to hate, you know, great techniques that can help you hate yourself. Like some people, for example, are like, stuff is going well. And they're like, well, how can I hate myself? Because things are going pretty good for me right now. And I'm like, oh no, there's always a way you can hate yourself. For example, you just lost 10 pounds and you feel really good about it. Wasn't 20. Mm-hmm. Now you can feel bad. Like double what you don't have.
Mm-hmm.
Double what you don't have. Oh, I just, there's always something to compare it to, or, you know, if you see a Tesla, you should feel bad. You don't have a Tesla. They're better than you. Like if you're George Clooney, how can you feel bad, right? How can you hate yourself if you're George Clooney? Well, you're not Bill Gates.
Your wife is taller than you are.
There's always something. And my mind is particularly gifted at finding it. So I can help you. I can help anyone hate themselves. So I do a thing, and then I like tell a story or do a bit or, you know, or whatever about how to hate yourself. And then I introduce people and comics and storytellers. So some people do more or less stand up under the topic of how to hate yourself, like stories or when it's come up or whatever. And some people like tell a big story that might be sad in parts or whatever. Like Tony Kameen is a great comedian. Mm-hmm. And he does not tell stories. And he was like, I don't know if this is funny at all, but of course it is. He's great. But he told this story of like just being a kid and his dad made him play baseball and it was terrible. And, you know, like he faked a bike accident to like get a girl's attention and like catch up on to look like blood and this whole thing to like and like wrecked his bike like in her car. And then she just ran in the house without even paying attention. And then he went and like knocked on the door, and then her mom was like, oh, come in. Oh, you had an accident. Oh, no. Yeah, come in. And then she was like, I saw everything. And he's like, So like, I just think everybody has, you know, this fucked up voice in their head.
Self-loathing. Is self-loathing patriotic? Isn't that the American way? Aren't we supposed to hate ourselves so we consume to fill that void?
That's interesting because the message is so like proud to be an American, but yes, the reality of being an American is you should always be buying something to feel better. It's not enough to just be an American, right?
Right. Now, I always say, I don't hate myself, I hate others. But then other people say, well, you hate others because you hate yourself. And I say, nah, I'm pretty sure I just hate you.
Yeah, I think that's fair. Greg Barrett went up and talked about that. He was like, I don't know if I hate myself. I definitely hate other people. And that was fun, too. So by the end of it, and people, you know, I have storytellers and comics and sometimes singers and stuff. And by the end of the night, it's neat because and then I do, you know, I host the show. So like by the end of the night, it's a little deeper than stand up, but also it's been really funny. And instead of just, to me, self-loathing is like when you don't identify that it's a voice doing this thing. You're just like, oh, I legitimately hate myself.
How many comedians hate themselves?
Oh, I got to say 100%. Probably.
I think that when I started doing comedy, I hated myself. But over time, the audience and my then wife healed me. I think if you can get enough love thrown your way, you can be humanized.
Yeah, I think so too. But also you said you didn't change, but now you just said you went from hating yourself to not hating yourself, which is a big change.
Yeah, I think the audience, I think they help you. It's sad that you need an audience, but they do.
No, it's a very extreme thing to need people to applaud till you feel better. It's when anybody's been like, oh, you do stand up, that's so brave. I'm like, is it? it seems much more like a needy mental illness.
Yeah.
But
okay. Yeah. And I'm doing it in a way, I'm going to piss you people off. I'm going to say horrible things. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, my father killed 70 Japanese during World War II. He never talked about it because it was inside an internment camp in California. I mean, like a horrible, horrible, like, now do you love me? Why don't you love me? I just said my father killed 75.
Oh,
I mean,
God.
It's really sick. I mean, I can remember being on the road and doing jokes about denting the fetus's head when I was making love to my pregnant wife and going, why didn't that joke work? Why don't they love me? And my friend going, because you just talked about poking your child in the head with your penis. Most normal people think that's offensive. And I'm going, but it's not true. It's not true. It doesn't matter. You were thinking that.
It's so valid. I saw you on stage and, you know, we go back to your being on the road and you were in Austin. But I saw you on stage and I remember like you. So you're doing pretty good. It was just like a regular. It was a Wednesday or Thursday, just like it wasn't like a big weekend night. And so, you know, an OK crowd. But like it was going good for like a half hour. And then you said something like I forget the joke exactly, but how it was like your kid makes art with, you know, string or macaroni or whatever, you know, some shitty kid art. And you were like, but when I make a tie out of human hair, I'm the bad guy.
I forgot that. Right. I forgot that. I can't remember how. Something about there's no
joke. Something about making a tie out of human hair, and you're like, but I can't do that.
My kid comes home and goes, Mommy, I made a sculpture of Abraham Lincoln out of macaroni. And everybody goes, oh, look how cute and beautiful that is. But I come home with a tie made out of human hair, and I'm sick.
Yes. Now, you said something like that. And there was like a, oh, and you addressed it because I was sitting there learning from you and Lewis Black and all the comics. And like, and that's all I cared about. Andy Kindler had some great ones. And you were like, you've been here. I understand if this was the first joke I told. You've been here for a half hour, enjoying, laughing. But suddenly you go, oh, he must have really done that. Like, what's wrong with you? You were like, you were just like, and I was like, that's so great. Like, you can buy into the, of course I'm making all this up. It's just funny, weird, wrong things to say. And then suddenly you're like, oh, you shouldn't make a tie out of human hair. That's a not good. That's not a proper thing a human does.
People remind me of jokes that I've done on stage, and they're always the jokes that never work. and they are the ones that make me laugh the hardest. There is a joke that I did in Vegas one night. Somebody reminded me of this joke, and I tried this joke three times, and it never worked. It's me in Vegas, and I said, you know, I went to the Mustang Ranch or the Bunnyland Ranch, and I grabbed a prostitute by the neck, started squeezing, and said, let me know when I get to $300. Now, what's the only thing that's funny about that is that I told that at like a fancy casino.
Oh my God.
Thinking, well, certainly they know that I would never do that.
Right.
That I'm playing a character who's mentally ill. The difference between Lewis Black and Andy Kindler and me is you can go to Lewis Black and say, well, this joke didn't work. They didn't get it. I don't know, or they weren't smart enough. And you can say to Andy Kindler, it was too esoteric. With me, you can say, usually, it didn't work because they got it and they think you're an idiot. Like, why would you tell that joke? They got it. Usually, when a joke doesn't work, I know that they got it, but they don't want to give it up for a guy squeezing a prostitute's neck and saying, let me know when I get to $300.
Yeah. I don't even understand any of that, because to me it's like, you know, you're at a comedy show. Like, he's not a guy sitting to you next to you on a plane, like, just telling you what he did last night. Like, it's a comedy show. You have a microphone in your hand.
Yeah.
But also I love comedy, and yeah, like, people who go to comedy shows are most likely a casual comedy goers, you know, like, yeah, sure, I like comedy. You know, it's not their number one thing they like. So they're not like, you build up like such an immune system to comedy that you need more and more wrong.
You know, I just realized, you know, what I just, you know, I just, we have to wrap it up, but you know what I just realized about myself in talking to you?
What?
There are these husbands who are happily married. They have kids. They're active in the church. They have a great job. They carpool. They mow the lawn. And then every Tuesday night at 3 a.m, they sneak out, go to the bus station, and do something horrible to a runaway. And then they come home.
Oh, okay.
And I think that's who I am with my comedy. I'm on the right page when it comes to politics, morality. I don't gamble. I don't drink. I don't do drugs. I don't chase women. I don't cheat. I don't lie. I pay my taxes. I'm a good, decent, hardworking, honest human being. Every week or two, I'll go on my show or Greg Fitzsimmons and say, yeah, I put my hands around a prostitute's neck and said, stop me when I get to $300. And then I get on with my life. It's my one little thing.
That's your thing. I I'm a terrible, I can only enable you. I can only enable you with it, because I'm like, good for you.
I say, it's okay to say horrible things. Don't do horrible things. Laura yeah. House, how do people follow you? This was so much fun. It was very good. This was a good, lazy Memorial Day conversation. This was good.
So you learned about yourself.
Uh-huh.
Twitter, I'm Laura House. I'm Laura House. LauraHouse.com is the website, and there's videos and stuff on there. It's fun. Spend the day at LauraHouse.com.
Great. Stay on the line. We're going to wrap it up. Thank you, Laura.